There is an old song that includes the words, "Gimme that old-time religion, it's good enough for me, and I hate it." I hate it because it paints a picture that the best way, and maybe even the only way, of observing, celebrating, or proclaiming our Christian faith is the way that it has always been done. Now, as we go through this today, it's important to remember that the Word of God does not change. And God Himself does not change. That's not just my opinion, that is the testimony of Scripture. Specifically, we can look at Hebrews 13:8 that says Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. Put that back up there. I want to read it and I want everybody to see it. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. Now, what that means, let's backtrack. Jesus Christ is the living Word. He is the Word made flesh. In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He is God. And He is everything about the Word manifest in the flesh and the dark. He does not change. And so anything or anybody that would tell you that in order, I think we lost some. Anybody or anything that would tell you that we as followers of Jesus have to change to be more relevant, to be more in sync with the culture, to be more palatable, and the insinuation being that the truth of Scripture is outdated and we need to update it, no, that is a lie. It does not change, He does not change, and those core truths about who we are do not change. We all on the same page with that? Good, because by the end you're not going to like me. Because here's the thing. The problem is this. The people and the culture that we are called to reach, they change and have changed a lot. And when they hear Christians and church people talk or sing about old-time religion, they hear outdated, old-fashioned, out of touch, and irrelevant. To them, it's not old-time religion, it is old wine religion. Let me explain. Go to the book of Luke, chapter 5. We'll pick up at verse 33. And what we find here is a very common scene in Scripture when Jesus is confronted by people who are questioning what He's doing, how He's ministering, how He is working, how God is working through Him, and questioning it in such a way that they're like, yeah, you can't possibly be of God, and certainly you are not God. And so what do you say about this? Trying to catch Him in some kind of way. And so these conversations happened all the time, and Jesus, of course, being perfect, always had the perfect answer that left His critics standing there, slack-jawed and drooling on their shoe, not sure what to say next. Luke chapter 5, picking up at verse 33. And they said to Him, "The disciples of John fast often and offer prayers, and so do the disciples of the Pharisees, but yours eat and drink." And Jesus said to them, "Can you make wedding guests fast while the bridegroom is with them. The days will come when the bridegroom is taken away from them, and then they will fast in those days. He also told them a parable. No one tears a piece from a new garment and puts it on an old garment. If he does, he will tear the new, and the piece from the new will not match the old. And no one puts new wine into old wineskins. If he does, the new wine will burst the skins, and it will be spilled, and the skins will be destroyed. But new wine must be put into fresh wineskins. And no one, after drinking old wine, desires new. For he says, the old is good. Now, first and foremost, how does that idea of new and old wine connect back to where he started with fasting? Well, you first have to remember the difference between law and grace. That's an important distinction to make. You have to remember the difference between salvation and righteousness attempting to be achieved through works versus salvation and righteousness being offered freely through Jesus. If the heart of fasting is rooted in a works-based belief about salvation and righteousness, then the point has been missed. For these people in first century Israel, it required a shift in thinking and believing. Fasting is really supposed to be about denying oneself with the intent of drawing closer to God. If I can simplify it, that's the best definition I can give you. It's a refocusing on what and who really matters. And that requires transformation. If the old traditions and religious rituals that the Pharisees were hanging on to, and the heart and mindset that went along with them, if those things were to persist while trying to include the new work that God was doing in and through Jesus, the whole thing would self-destruct. You have to put new wine in new wineskins because old wineskins no longer have the ability to stretch and accommodate what takes place during the fermentation process. Talking about literal wine, there are gases that are released as things ferment in there, and it's going to stretch that wineskin. Old wineskins have already been through that, and unless you somehow make them new again, they can't contain the new wine. So the old wineskins, the people who refuse to be made new or be transformed, will continually just keep going back to the old wine, the old ways, the old way of thinking, the old methods. And some will say, yeah, but if we could only get people to understand how good it is to know and be known by Jesus. Oh, and you'd be right. You're right. But we will never achieve that part of our mission as believers and followers of Jesus by offering stale bread to the people we are trying to reach. This is the same idea as having someone to your home for dinner, baking a fresh loaf of homemade bread that comes out perfectly, mwah, chef kiss, and then serving week-old bread that has been sitting on your counter going stale because you'd rather use it up first. And then you wonder why nobody ate enough of that bread to get to the point that you were ready to cut into the fresh loaf. And nobody ever experienced how good that bread was because you were serving something that was old, dried out, and stale. When we try to introduce people to Jesus by using stale bread and old wine, Those are methods and traditions that really have nothing to do with real biblical truth and Holy Spirit-driven transformation. We are cutting ourselves off at the knees, and we are setting up roadblocks before we even get started. So the question that we have to ask ourselves is this. Are we committed to the call of Christ or consumed with a commitment to idols we didn't even know we had? Let me be clear. There's nothing wrong with nostalgia or tradition until those things become an idol and you can no longer worship without them. Now, here's the part where some of you get mad, and I'm prepared for it. The quickest place people run to when it comes to this topic is music. Did you feel the clench? There it was. Because you know where I'm going. The worship wars. If you've been around the church long enough, you're familiar with that term, the worship wars. They were a very real thing going back a couple decades ago and even further. And they still rear their ugly head every now and again. So let me use this as an example as we go a little further with this today. And let me tell you a story from a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away when I was very new here at LifeSong and I was the worship pastor. I came into a situation that was chaotic at best. Some crazy things had happened in the church about 6 months before I came on board. I didn't know anything about those, really. What I knew coming in is that the worship team and the worship ministry was in a rough space. The person who was trying to lead worship was a really great vocalist, but not a musician. And so leading musicians was really, really difficult for her. And then behind her, as far as musicians were concerned, you had a lot of people who were really committed and good at what they did and knew enough about music to just be dangerous. And that's the reason that the church was looking for a worship leader or a worship pastor. They needed somebody to give direction and to provide leadership for that ministry. And so I came in, and there were all different levels of musicianship and all different ages of people. We had students who were like, I think, 14-ish years old, all the way up to somebody who was in their 70s, okay? And it spanned that spectrum. And there were all different levels of musical ability represented there, too. And so everything that was done had to keep in mind what our team was capable of doing. And I would stretch them, and I would challenge them, and I would try to get them to push in and press in and go a little further. But you have to be gentle with that kind of thing. And just like nobody would come to you who's never picked up a hammer and say, go build a house, you can't go to a musician and say, here, play this music that you don't even have the skills or knowledge to be able to play in the first place. And so with that came some limitations. With that came some challenges. And with that came the need to adjust some things. At that point in this church's history, we still included in our worship sets some hymns. We'll get to why we don't anymore. We didn't have somebody who could read sheet music. We didn't have a piano player or a keyboard player who is capable of sitting down and looking at a hymnal and going and playing all the notes. We didn't have that. So what we did have were people who could read chords on a page, and we could arrange those hymns in such a way that a modern worship band could play them. And then one day, I went in to a meeting that was supposed to be a Q&A with all the pastors of the church. And I got hit so hard in that meeting because of this. The people who wanted those hymns so badly didn't want to hear that our musicians couldn't play from a hymnal. They didn't just want the hymns they wanted. They wanted the hymns they wanted the way they wanted, and there was no room for discussion or debate. And so at that point, I'm not the lead pastor. I go to the lead pastor. I say, what do you want to do about this? They're asking for something we can't give them. And so at that point, we brought someone in from outside who periodically throughout the year during the Sunday school hour would come in, and instead of doing Sunday school, we would do a hymn sing. And the first time we did the hymn sing, a few dozen people came out for it. And the second time we did the hymn sing, about half of those people came out for it. And the third time we did the hymn sing, about half of that half came out for it. And by the fourth time we did the hymn sing, about a handful of people were still showing up. Now, those songs were being done the way they wanted, how they wanted. There was nothing that could be complained about by that. And I still got some of the most critical, hateful, and demeaning statements lobbed at me as the worship pastor because those songs weren't done that way in worship services on Sunday morning. And that's the point when my mind and my heart went, there's an idol right there. And so as time wore on and God moved me through growing in ministry and I stepped out of being worship pastor and into being lead pastor, I said, we're not going to have any idols at Lifesong Family Church. And that's the first one I've seen, and so it's going to go. And I know some of you love those old hymns, and I love you. But I'm not going to bring stale bread, old wine, and idols as an offering before our God. So if you have questions about why we do what we do when it comes to musical worship, don't go ask Grayson. Come to me. Because he's following my direction. And I'm following the direction of the Holy Spirit, who's the one who's really leading and in charge in the first place. But here's the deal. See, we run to music because it's an easy identifier, right? And we can easily see the difference because what we do when it comes to musical worship is vastly different than what the Wesley brothers did years and years and years and years and years ago. You know, the funny thing is that I believe that when those men who sat down and wrote some of the great old hymns of the church, when they wrote those things, because I'm a musician and because, to some degree, I'm a songwriter, I don't believe that those men had any expectation that 500 years later we would still be clinging to those fresh expressions of worship as the only and good way. No, in their time, they were writing something new. They were presenting a fresh offering to the Lord. They were calling the church to sing about what was happening in the church in that day. They didn't intend for the songs they wrote to become idols. 9 different times throughout Scripture, the Word of God says to sing a new song to the Lord. But worship is much more than just singing. Everything we do can and should be an offering of worship and praise to God. So I've given you the example of the musical worship, but now let's talk about the rest of life. Romans chapter 12, verses 1 through 3. Romans 12, starting at verse 1, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed. And if you've got a paper Bible or a digital copy that you can underline or highlight, transformed. Underline it, highlight it, circle it, star it, whatever you can do. be transformed by the renewal or the renewing, another underline and highlight word, of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. We are to be transformed, renewed, and remember that we are not the most important person in the room. I know that's a hard thing for some of us to swallow. But the thing we have to really understand is that when we gather as the body of Christ, we all believe that Jesus is in the room, right? There ain't nobody more important than him. There ain't nobody's ideas or opinions or preferences or any of it that's more important than Jesus. And so when we're gathered as the church, none of us get to be the most important person in the room. It's always going to be and has to be him. Reaching the world is going to require that we be willing to speak their language. Now, we can go to extremes with that, and I don't want to go to extremes with that. And I don't think anybody who's preaching the word faithfully will call you to go to extremes with that. I shared on my personal Facebook account here a couple of weeks ago, a pastor from some other church somewhere, reading an excerpt of scripture from a real translation of the Bible, but the language that it's translated into is the language of Gen Z. I'm not even going to attempt. It frightens me that I understood about 90% of it. That's because I have some of those people from that generation who live in my house. I'm not advocating necessarily for that, okay? I think we do need to teach young people to actually speak English and not some weird amalgamation of whatever that is, okay? But how many of us, and if you do, this is fine, but how many of us carry around with us or keep with us as a daily reader a King James Bible? Not many. Not many, because why? Because that is not the way you speak. My apologies. Thou dost not speaketh in that manner. Right? You have probably a translation, if you have a daily reader that you keep with you, you have a translation that speaks the unchanging truth of Scripture, the Word of God, to you in a way that makes sense and you can understand. Right? So when we start to speak to the world about Jesus, we need to be doing it in a way that makes sense, and at the beginning, they can understand. Now, there's always going to be things that confound sinners about the truth of the gospel. How do I know that? Because I am one, was one, are one. Huh, are we? My pastor was a sinner? You betcha. And I was really good at it in a lot of ways. And so were you. And some of us still are. Amen. Mm-hmm. We're not talking about changing the truth. We're talking about changing the way it's communicated. Or being intentional about communicating it in a way that the world can hear. Now, I heard the best analogy of this when I was a very young Christian, my very first pastor in the church where I got saved. And the analogy that he gave was the Wheaties box. Now, we all know what the Wheaties box is, right? If you don't, it's a breakfast cereal. And like you can see on the screen, they put famous sports figures of the day on the front of the box. And some of you, especially people who are under the age of 30 right now, are looking at those four people, real people who are on the front of real Wheaties boxes, and the people under 30 are going, who are those people? Now, Wheaties puts those people on the boxes, not only as a way of honoring the athlete and that kind of thing, but when they've set some kind of new record in their sport, when they've achieved a status in their sport and they're going to be inducted into some hall of fame, if they've earned medals in the Olympics, hey, people are excited about that. People are excited about that. And they want to grab that box with that famous sports figure, and not only because they want the cereal that's inside, but all of these pictures are real pictures of boxes that people purchased at some point in the past and have saved and still have till this day. They become collector's items. There are people who look at those, and some of you in this room go, I remember when Larry Bird was on the Wheaties box. And then there are people in this room going, who is Larry Bird? The front of the Wheaties box is always changing. It's always different, it's always new, and it's always relevant to the world today. But in the box, Wheaties have always been Wheaties. It's the same bland, boring bran flakes. It's just how it's presented that catches the attention of people. Some will say, Pastor, you already said that Jesus doesn't change. Now, don't you go talking about changing what the Bible says or redefining sin or any of that woke nonsense. Relax, okay? That is not what I'm talking about at all. I need you to hear me on that. I've said it a million times, I feel like, already in this message, and I'll say it once more. I'm not talking about changing the truth of Scripture, of who Jesus is, of who God is, of sin and righteousness. I'm not talking about changing any of that. Not in the least. We don't compromise on those core essentials. But just like the package changes for Wheaties, we have to be willing to adjust our presentation of the gospel to meet the world where they are today. Let me take you back to Wheaties. If Bruce Jenner was on a Wheaties box today, how many of you would go out and buy it? Don't answer the question. But years ago, when he was in the Olympics and was on the Wheaties box, many of you probably felt very different than what you just went about. See, what's on the box would change your mind about whether or not you're going to buy it. But the thing is, the cereal is still the same. You just wouldn't buy it now because of what was presented on the outside. And before you try to say, well, that's not how God works, Isaiah, Old Testament prophet who had a lot to say about the forthcoming Messiah, chapter 43, verses 18 and 19, says, remember not the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. Oh, yes, God does new things. He never changes, but he is constantly running after his people, running after the lost. He is constantly in pursuit of a broken and hurting and dying world. And we are called to run that race. And we will be led by the Spirit of God. We will be inspired by the Spirit of God. We will be challenged and stretched by the Spirit of God. And we will also be afforded the opportunity to figure out how we communicate changeless and timeless truth to an ever-changing culture. And as a matter of fact, it is a call on God's people to be welcoming to those who are strangers to us. Now, I'm going to take a little bit of liberty with that language because this is Joe Boyd speaking from his own personal opinions and perspective on life, okay? This is not the Word of God. But we live in a culture that is presently full of a wealth of strangers. Strange people and opinions and positions and practices and lifestyles and stuff that we're like, where did that even come from? And we are called to welcome the strangers. In the same passage in Hebrews where it states that Jesus doesn't change, if you rewind just a few verses, Hebrews 13, verse 2, do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares. Now, this is quite possibly a reference to real, actual angels that may have appeared in a human form. There is Old Testament basis for that kind of thing taking place. But it also points us to the reality that God will send people to you with the intent that you are the one who helps to start them out on their journey toward knowing Jesus. But if we refuse to be hospitable, welcoming, engaging, and intentional about creating a space, an environment where they feel that they are welcomed and at home, we very well may miss that opportunity. For at least 2 years, maybe longer, it has been the desire of my heart to see a rebirth and a resurgence of a ministry in this church that was focused exactly on that. The welcoming of people, the creating of an environment where people are not only welcomed, but embraced and made to feel not only at home, but that they are wanted and valuable and have a place here. And the problem of why that's been the desire of my heart, but not the reality before my eyes, is that I cannot stand in the lobby and in the parking lot and lead people down the hallway all at the same time by myself. And a lot of the other people who get the importance of that kind of ministry are already engaged in other ministries. And so I've just been waiting, and I've just been praying, and I've just been believing that when the time was right, God would move somehow, some way, and either bring a person forward who said, I really feel like we need to do this, or a group of people forward who said, hey, we would really like to. And this morning, about 5 minutes before service, Pastor Gary pulled me aside and said, I need to talk to you about something that our senior adults would like to take on. And so, the new wineskins of the seasoned saints are about ready to get filled up with some new wine and start leading the charge in welcoming people to Lifesong Family Church. I am so grateful for y'all. And we'll talk more about that, those of you who are excited for it and interested in it, and you don't have to be a senior adult to be involved with it, but God will raise up his servants from wherever he sees fit. And right now, it's them. Praise God for it. So, what was I saying? Good question. We have to be willing to do that. We have to be willing to welcome people. And here's the thing. When people hit that front door for the very first time, you know nothing about them. Nobody's coming in and filling out a questionnaire about their theological stance on what is this and how is that and what's the Holy Spirit and what is Jesus and what's the Trinity and all of this. No, we're not doing that. Nobody's checking a box whether they're Democrat or Republican, independent, libertarian. Nope, we're not asking. All we're doing is we're seeing the people that God brought to the door and being grateful that they're here, no matter what the details are. But here's the other challenge. Okay, we get in our own way, right? We've already covered that. But see, there are some things that work against us, even though we didn't do anything to create them. It's a product of culture and society, and then some things that maybe we have done, and even generations before us have done. The perception of what a Christian is from both the church and the world is oftentimes skewed in such a way that we have to overcome that before we can even begin to have a conversation with someone. And so there's a stereotypical idea that floats around the world of what a Christian looks like. Show us the pictures. Okay, so that's from left to right, that's Billy Graham, T.D. Jakes, Joyce Meyer, and Joel Osteen. Now, I'm not here to talk about their theology or their churches or their ministries or any of that kind of thing. We're not digging into those details. What I want to point out is, look, all three men, suits and ties. Joyce, dressed to the nine, earrings, makeup, I'm sure, professionally done for that headshot photo. Man, I am underdressed. But those are high-profile Christians. Those are people that you hear on the radio and see on TV and streamed online to massive, massive audiences. And Billy Graham, who doesn't know who Billy Graham is? Even the under 30 people are like, oh, I know who Billy Graham is. Yeah. Really under 30 people. But so much of the world outside the church, when they hear Christian, they think of that kind of image. They think of those examples. And a lot of times they think of what they teach and what they represent from their own pulpits and ministries, and they have heard things that they don't agree with or have hurt their hearts or whatever it is. And another part of that, yes, is the conviction of the Holy Spirit, but that is oftentimes what we have to overcome as a representation of who we are, good or bad. I didn't even know this, but I was faced actually about a year and a half ago with having to overcome that exact mentality and perception by somebody who was a believer. In the fall of 2022, I was a part of the community Thanksgiving service that the Ministerial Association puts on each year. And I think they just asked me to close out in prayer or something like that. And I dressed for that service like I do for a service here, because they're going to get me how you get me. And I don't own a suit currently. So I showed up in jeans and some kind of boots or dress type shoes, and I remember exactly what I was wearing. It was a long-sleeved, snap front, like plaid print shirt. You know what I wear. Because if you're paying attention, you know. And the sleeves rolled up. And I got up, and I spoke a little, and I prayed, and I, you know, just skipped on, blissfully ignorant, grateful to God for the opportunity. A year later, in November of 2023, I was asked to co-preach the message for the community Thanksgiving service. And so I got there a little bit early and just wanted to get situated, and I went and spoke to the tech team about, well, you know, what's the microphone situation, and you know, all, notes and all of that sort of stuff. And I put my stuff down at a seat on the front row in the auditorium. And then I just started to walk to wherever I was going. There weren't a lot of people in there yet at that point. And a man who I did not know, from over here on my right, says, "Pastor Joe." I'm like, I don't know this voice. I don't know this face. Now, as a pastor, when an unknown voice and an unknown face says, "Hey, pastor," you have no idea what you're about to get drawn into. But okay, hey, how are you? It says, "I have owed you an apology for a year." And I'm like, okay. I'm thinking, can we start with who are you? I have owed you an apology for a year. Because last year, when you got up there, before you said anything, I looked at you and I thought to myself, what kind of a pastor is that? A pastor ought not look like that. And then you spoke, and I was so wrong, and I am sorry. And I thought, I didn't even know that you thought that, but thank you. Thank you for that. Thank you for, as he went on a little bit, thank you for that encouragement. And my snap front, rolled up sleeve, plaid shirt, jeans, and whatever boots stretched that man's perception of what not just a pastor, but a Christian could look like. So there's the old perception that we saw. Billy Graham, T.D. Jakes, Joyce Meyer, Joel Osteen. And apart from Billy Graham, who's gone home to the Lord, they're all still out there doing ministry right now. Now I want to show you another picture. From left to right, that is Alice Cooper, Mr. T, Kat Von D, and MC Hammer. Alice Cooper, yeah, that's a dude. Yes, his name is Alice. Alice Cooper is kind of a hard rock icon. Been around for a long time. His dad was a pastor. And Alice Cooper professes with his mouth a faith in Jesus Christ. Mr. T, you know, he was on the A-team, and he was huge in like the 80s, and I think even early, Pity the Fool, you know? Mr. T with his like frohawk thing he's got going on and the gold chains, and when he's in the sleeveless shirt, I mean, biceps that would crack a walnut, professes with his mouth a faith in Jesus Christ. Kat Von D, a more recent example, she is one of the premier female tattoo artists in the world. And rather recently has professed faith in Christ and been baptized. And the last one, I mean, you can't even touch this. It's MC Hammer. Oh, oh. Not only was he a hip-hop icon several decades ago, he professes a faith in Jesus and actually is a minister or a pastor. And none of them look anything like the first picture. Now, I'm not here to debate their theology or the fruit that we see in any of their lives. What I know is that the Bible says, confess with your mouth and believe in your heart. I can't see their heart. I don't know their heart. All I can do is read or hear their words, and they say, I believe that Jesus Christ is my Savior. So here's the deal. I'm not saying that we put any of them on a platform because they're just people like you and me. But they're a great example of people who don't fit the stereotypical mold that are still believers and followers of Jesus. And so when you're faced with the stale bread perception of, oh, all Christians are uptight, suit wearing, you know, just that, just I can't do that. Have you heard of Alice Cooper? Do you know who Mr. T is? How about Kat Von D? How about MC Hammer? You got to go back a little ways. Don't use MC Hammer for the under 30 crowd, okay? Stick to the Kat Von D, all right? Those are brothers and sisters in Christ, just like the suits and ties and dress to the nines. And they all have flaws and struggles and hardships, just like the suits and ties and dress to the nines. See, what we present on the outside oftentimes is very deceptive of what's truly inside. And so while the world might look at the first picture and go, I can't be that. I don't want that. I don't even want to entertain what it might take to become that. Too many people in the church look at this picture and say, that can't be a Christian. And yet, they've confessed with their mouth, Jesus Christ is Lord. Now, how does that compute? How does that work? How can we be so divergent in those two ends of the spectrum? Well, because it's God doing a work in people. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 17 through 21. Say, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. Meaning it's the ministry now to preach that gospel so others may be reconciled to God. Verse 19, that is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, He made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. There's a lot there, and we don't have a lot of time to really dig deep. But let's first start with the problem. Some people misunderstand and believe that they were made new on the day they got saved, and they have just been new ever since. Like, Jesus changed me on October 27th, 1972. And I've been changed the same, but changed ever since. Problem is, sanctification says he who began a good work in you will be faithful to complete it. Sanctification being a process that lasts your entire life. You started being made new on that day and will continue being made new every day for the rest of your life until you close your eyes here and open them in heaven, when you become the best version of you that will ever exist for eternity. He didn't just make you new in a crisis moment and that was it, you're good to go. There's a constant refining that is taking place. And so what that means is, if we're the wineskins, we don't have to be resolved to be old, stretched out, and useless. There's a renewal, a constant renewal that takes place. Just because the world is so different from what you once knew does not mean that you are not able to be an effective ambassador of Christ still. Not in the least. But you gotta be willing. You gotta be willing to let God do that work in you. You gotta be willing to let him renew and restore and revive. You got to be willing to call an idol and let some things go for the sake of the call and cause of Christ. We are to be ambassadors, according to the scripture, ambassadors, not of the way things were done in the first century, or the 1800s, or the 1950s, or 1990s, or 2002. We are to be ambassadors of a God, a Savior, and a kingdom that is for all people right now in these times that we are living in. When an ambassador of the United States of America goes overseas to represent our country, he's going to go into that culture either knowing or very quickly learning how to relate to that culture, to those people, how to speak the language. The same thing exists in missionaries. Send a missionary to the other side of the world, somewhere in Asia or Africa or somewhere where they speak like clicks and boops or something. That missionary is not going to go in and suddenly expect the click boop tribe, the Umklucklucks, I'm sorry, that's what we call them. That's made up people. That missionary is not going to go in and expect the Umklucklucks to speak the king's English. He's going to go in and learn Umklucklucks so that he can speak the gospel in the language of the people. We're faced with the same challenge. We're faced with the same call. We are faced with the truth that we cannot bring stale bread to a lost and dying world and expect them to partake of and receive the goodness of Jesus Christ. That is what we're called to do. That is who we are called to be. We are called to go wherever he will send us, to the ends of the earth even. Not to bring old and worn out, but to bring new life. Life abundantly, life to the full, life everlasting that is only found in Jesus Christ. And so as the worship team comes back today, I'm going to ask you to consider and weigh some difficult things. And the first place that I'm going to ask you to start is with the idols in your life. Idols that until maybe right now, you didn't even know you had. What are those things that you look at or think about and say to yourself, if I didn't have this or without this, I could not worship God. I could not be a follower of Jesus. And if there's anything on that list that is not directly rooted and connected to the truth of Scripture and to Christ himself, then you need to start asking God how you need to deal with that. How you need to let it go. I'm not saying that you kick it completely out of your life. Remember, nostalgia and traditions? Those can be good things in the proper place. And as the Holy Spirit does that renewing and transforming and sanctifying work in you, then ask the question, if this isn't how I do it, if this isn't how they need to hear it, then how do I? Show me. Lead me, guide me, use me for your glory and your kingdom. And while the Holy Spirit does that in those people who are wrestling with those things right now and wondering if they still love me, if you're in the room today and that second picture hit you with a realization that you didn't know you could still be you and a follower of Jesus, today's a great day to step into that new life. He's not calling you to come and suddenly be this whole new, perfect on the outside, dressed to the nines, suit and tie, whatever it is, slick and shiny image. No. No. No, he's calling you. He's calling you to come and be a sold out, committed follower of Jesus. with a whole sleeve of tattoos. With crazy, weird, long hair and makeup, or pick any one of those gold chains. You want, you know what? MC McDiddy or whatever you want to be called. And the transformation that takes place is not about what you look like on the outside. It's about how he transforms you from the inside out, makes you a new creation, and is faithful to be with you through every stage of life. That he never leaves you or forsakes you. But it's constantly refining you. Making you new. Making you whole. So I want to pray with you today. And just let God continue to do what he needs to do in each one of us. So Father, we come to you and we thank you for your word. We thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you for the truth of who you are, that you do not change, that you are steadfast, immovable, and that you are a God who calls out to every person on this planet. That you are full of love for them, a love that motivated you to step out of the glory of heaven, put on the flesh of a man, and die a criminal's death to pay the price for each of our sins. And Jesus, when you went to that cross, you were aware of all of our flaws, all of our failures. You are aware of the things that make us unique, the things that make us weird, the things that make us feel like we don't belong, the things that make us believe that this is not a place where we could ever be welcome. You were aware of all of those things, and you died for us anyway. So today, for those who are in that place, for anybody who's ever felt unwanted and unwelcome, uninvited to be a part of your kingdom, of your church, if that is you today, the call of Jesus is come home, believe and receive the salvation of the Lord. He does not expect you to have it all figured out today. And so we simply start with one step of faith and say, Jesus, I believe that you are the Son of God, who died in my place, paid the price for my sin, so that I could be saved and reconciled to God. I give you my life. I believe. I believe that you are my Savior. That you have gone to prepare a place for me. That one day, at the end of this life, I will have life with you forever. And as the hosts of heaven armies of angels cheer and rejoice over those who have just come home. Our hearts swell with gratitude and excitement for the work that you have done here today, God. And as we prepare to go, we ask you, Holy Spirit, to continue to search our hearts, to seek out those things that we have held so tightly to, they've become roadblocks to the advancement of your kingdom through us. Help us learn, help us know, help us grow into people who can speak to our culture, who can speak to our world, who can offer hope when nothing and no one else can, who can offer peace when everything else is in chaos, who can offer joy when the world is plagued with depression and darkness, who can offer the only truth that will save. Help us speak it. Help us live it. Help us carry it to the world. For all this, we praise you. We thank you. We rejoice that we do not go alone, that over every circumstance and situation, you are God. You rule, you reign over every part of creation. You reign above it all, Jesus. Be glorified today as we praise you for all that you have done. We love you, we thank you. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Hey, I hope that you've been blessed by this word, encouraged or challenged in some kind of way. If you are joining us for the first time, remember that the experience does not end here. I want to invite you to visit lifesongfamily.org/connect and fill out that digital connect card so we can get to know you better and find out how we can serve you and your family better here at Lifesong Family Church. Of course, be sure to like and follow us on Facebook. You can find us on Instagram and Twitter as well, so you can keep up with everything that is happening here at Lifesong Family Church. And as always, as you are able, we invite you to join us in person right here in Lewisburg, Tennessee. We can't wait to see you.